Sir, good evening, everyone. So in this difficult time, COVID times, the one thing which I missed was being with the postgraduates and teaching them. So I thank really the IOA President, Dr. R.C. Mina sir, Dr. Atul, and Professor Rajagopalan, and the entire team for having given me this opportunity to present. So this is greetings from my institution, Madras Medical College. Now it has essentially become almost a COVID center. Very, very sad to see, because so much of work was happening, and now it is COVID in the present time. So after this brilliant talk by Dr. Naresh, it is a very difficult act to follow. But as he rightly said, that well-taken history will take you into the right place. And if you are organized, then you'll know the way. If you are disorganized, then it will be like in a maze, in the middle of a maze, and it is very difficult to find the direction. So a problem which is well-defined is half solved. So if you present a good history, then it is only to confirm whatever you have learned from the history. So when you start the examination, so most of the time, most of the examiners, they expect the gate to be told first, which Dr. Taneja sir is going to speak. I'm not going to talk about gate, but in our part of a country, we tell it at the end. So we have our own reasons. One is that when the patient walks into your consultation room, we learn a lot by seeing the patient walking. But in your examination, the patient will be already lying. Straight away asking him to walk, it will be painful, and whether he's going to cooperate for your examination, it is the question. Second is, when you have examined the patient, a lot of things you would have learned, and a lot of things you will be able to explain it in the gate when he's walking. Third and most important is that the examiners might have corrected a lot of your findings, and there will be an occasion, opportunity for you to change it in the gate, taking all those points. If you say it, you commit it in upfront, the gate, then it may be difficult for you to change all those things. So when you see this young boy carelessly walking, so it will be very, very difficult to, unless you are a very experienced clinical examiner, it will be very difficult. Unless you find out that the right hip, there is range of movement, there is stiffness, and it is painless, and the patient walks with a stiff hip gait. So with that, either it is absolutely perfect, whether you are going to say it upfront or at the end, which Dr. Taneja sir will be telling, it is absolutely fine. Then coming to the general examination. So you examine the patient as a whole, like in any other condition, general vitals and everything. And the height and arm span you have to measure. The ligamentous laxity, the Bayton's criteria, you'll have to make a mention. And whether there are any obvious markers which are there. And if it is a pediatric age group, but there are certain conditions where you have to mention about the IQ and the secondary sexual characters, whether they have developed everything adequately. So a general word about the general examination. And if there is anything like a torticollis, for example, if it is there, then you'll have to mention, because torticollis is associated often with the developmental dysplasia of the hip. So all those things, if you miss, then it may be difficult. So it is better to have a general look of the patient. Then coming to the examination proper of the hip joint, it is always better to say the patient as he's standing, he's sitting, but most of the examination findings, everything will be on lying down. So what you're expected to see in the patient is standing. And the patient is standing, whether the head is centered, both shoulders at level, if there is any shortening, then, or if there is any other pathology, pelvic tilt, then there will be one which is elevated or one which is depressed. The scoliosis associated because of the pelvic deformity, whether it is there. And the coronal plane deformity or the sagittal plane deformity, like kyphosis, when there is a smooth rounded kyphosis, which is a telltale of the ankylosing spondylitis, or whether there is an exaggerated lordosis, which tells us about the flexion deformity of the hip. When there is a limb shortening, then that will produce pelvic obliquity or any other thing like the equinus deformity of the ankle or the other knee, which is flexed. All those things you'll have to make a mention. Then if the examiner asks you, how will you correct it? Then you can say some wooden blocks, you can put it, correct the height difference, discrepancy, so that whether the pelvic tilt is corrected or not. Or is it a fixed pelvic tilt, which is due to some other reason. In sitting position, the spine, if the scoliosis is because of the shortening, then that will be corrected and the spine will be straight. And when there is a femoral shortening, the level of the knee joint will tell us whether there is a femoral shortening or not. So having said about the lying down position, I mean the standing and sitting, then we come to the examination as the patient is made to lie down. He must be adequately exposed on both lower limbs together. And it is preferable to have a hard couch, but you cannot insist, you don't have a choice. If it is on the bed, if it is firm, then it's fine. But it's better if you examine the patient on a hard couch. there are certain things which you have to compare both lower limbs first before you go to the examination of the hip proper, whether the lordosis is increased or not. That can be easily seen in the light on the opposite side. You are able to see when you are at the level of the lumbar spine, when your eye is at the level of the lumbar spine, when the light is seen or whatever it is on the opposite side, you are able to see, then it means that the lumbar lordosis increased. But always it need not be. If the patient is obese, if the flanks are loose and hanging down, it might be touching the couch and still there may be an exaggerated lordosis. But in inspection, you have to make a mention. The anterior superiliac spine, you'll have to look from above. Don't look from the side, you'll have a parallax error and you will not be able to exactly appreciate whether the anterior superiliac spine is at high or a low level. Then the attitude and the deformity. Make the patient the limbs and they are along the axis of the trunk. If that is there, then you describe whether the hip is extended, whether it is internal or external rotated, the knee is extended and the foot and ankle in position of ease. Whether there is any deformity, you'll have to make a mention. There is a wasting, the quadriceps muscle wasting, it is there, then that indicates that there is some pathology which is happening. The limb length discrepancy, of course, you'll have to make a mention, the level of the knee, the level of the medial malleus, which tell us whether there is a limb length discrepancy. So in this patient, if you see, if it is a scaphoid abdomen, if a thin individual, the exaggerated lordosis can be very well seen. And when you look from above, you'll be able to see the difference. The anterior superiliac spine is at a lower level, this is at a higher level. The external rotation is there, the patella is facing outwards. So all those things you'll be able to see that. And then you come to the inspection of the affected hip, the hip proper. In the hip proper, you'll have to inspect about the scarpa triangle, whether there's any swelling, scar or sinus. Don't tell like looking from the front, looking from the side, looking from the back and looking on the inner side. So you can just progressively say it should be a smooth flow. That will tell the examiner that you are very confident. So from the front, the scarpa triangle, whether there is any swelling, scar or sinuses that are present. The greater trochanter, whether you are able to see the greater trochanter, the level of the greater trochanter, whether there is any obvious swelling. That level of the greater trochanter can be assumed by the supratrochanteric hollowness as well as the prominence of the greater trochanter. In an obese patient, you are not able to see that and everything is obese, single. Then you have to tell the examiner, I'm not able to assume the level of the trochanter, whether there is any sinus or scar. Never forget to make the patient lie on the lateral or the prone position. See the posterior aspect because there may be a swelling, there may be a posterior dislocation, the mass on the posterior aspect, which you will not be able to see, the gluteal fold, the gluteal wasting, everything. So that you have to definitely turn the patient and see there may be some surprises and on the medial aspect of. So once the inspection is completed, then you come for the palpation. So the exaggerated lumbar lordosis you have to confirm. So how do you confirm? You just pass on your hand. Normally there is a lordosis. The fingers will pass beneath the lumbar spine, but it can go only up to the level of the knuckle. The normal knuckles cannot pass the midline of the patient. So if the knuckles pass the midline, it means that there is an exaggerated lordosis. So that is how you confirm that there is exaggerated lordosis or not. And confirmation of the anterior superiliac spine. If it is low, then it means that there is an abduction deformity may be present. If it is high, it means an adduction deformity. But how do you make out the anterior superiliac spine? That is very, very important. How do you mark it? A lot of the students, they make a mistake. They just palpate over the anterior superiliac spine. If it is a flabby abdomen and the skin is moving here and there, if you mark without taking care, then you will be marking in a wrong place. So if you see this video, so you can see that you have to palpate along the inguinal ligament. The thumb, the resistance what it encounters is the anterior superiliac spine. You have to hitch the inch tape, metal tip of the inch tape against the anterior superiliac spine and then mark it like that. So that is the right way of marking the anterior superiliac spine. Just marking over the anterior superiliac spine, it will lead on to some fallacy while you are doing the length. So that marking of the anterior superiliac spine is very, very important. Once you have done that, the lordosis and the anterior superiliac spine, you come to the scarpa triangle. First thing in any palpation will be testing the warmth, whether it is warm, whether tenderness is present, where is the tenderness? Is it at the base of the scarpa triangle where the femoral pulse is felt, just half an inch below and lateral to the midinguinal point? The swelling, whether it is there or not, and the vascular sign of Narath, whether the volume character is comparable to the opposite side. So this vascular sign of Narath, you can tell it now or also in the special test. If you make a mention that the femoral pulse is felt equally on both sides, even if you forget it in special test, it's all right. But if you keep it for the end and you're not seeing, then the examiner will definitely ask you, you have not palpated the femoral pulse. So So that is very important. Then come to the trochanter. The trochanter, you have to palpate on the lateral side. You have to go up to the top of the trochanter. You have to see whether the trochanter is at the same level or is it elevated or depressed. If you are finding it difficult in an obese person, you flex and adduct it, then you will be able to easily palpate the trochanter, then bring it to the normal level. And then that point you can see. So you have to see the top of the trochanter, whether it is at the same level. Then you'll have to palpate the surface, whether it is smooth or it is irregular. You have to compare it with the opposite side, whether it is thickened or broadened. So are there two terms? Thickening is the medial lateral, but will you be able to see the medial aspect to see the thickening of the trochanter? So when you palpate the surface, when it is irregular, and you feel that when compared to the opposite side, it is broadened, then it is thickening, or it is broadening can be anteroposterior. So this is a fine line which if some examiner asks, you can mention. And there is a tenderness. The tenderness, there are two tenderness. Anteroposteriorly, keeping your thumb and the other digits on either side, anteroposteriorly if you compress and there is tenderness, it is called as the pertrochanteric tenderness. It means that there is some pathology in the trochanter. And if there is no pathology in the trochanter, if you press the trochanter along its axis of the neck, on either both the trochanter, you keep your hand and really press hard, then if there is tenderness, it can be either in the trochanter, in the neck, in the head, or in the acetabulum. So anywhere it is called as a transmitted tenderness. If in an obese person, or if you are very thin and you are finding it difficult to use your pectorals and then you are able to compress on both trochanters, a good idea will be to keep the patient on lateral position and then you can compress on the trochanter. That will be easy and elicit by trochanteric tenderness. So once trochanter is done, you have to turn and see the gluteal region, whether there is any fullness, any warmth or tenderness, and whether there is any mass. The mass is very important. It can be two. Either it can be a myositis mass or the head of femur. If it is smooth, rounded, and if it is moving along with the movement of the femur, the thigh, then it is the head of femur. If it is just a mass, it may be a myositis, because gluteal, the myositis in the gluteal region is next common to the elbow and knee. So the myositis mass we can always expect. Then palpation of the other bony prominences, the ilium, the pubis, the ischial tuberosity, don't forget to palpate all those things. So once you have finished the inspection and then you have finished the palpation, then you come for the demonstration of the fixed deformities. So before you go to the movement, you have to find out whether there are any fixed deformities. You have to tell the examiner whether there is any sagittal plane deformity, flexion deformity, or if there is any coronal plane adduction or abduction deformity. So for doing the flexion, finding out there is flexion deformity or not, you do what is called as a Thomas hip knee flexion test. So this, you all know that you flex the normal hip, you palpate for the lordosis with your hand, you keep the hand there, you flex the hip till the spine touches your hand. So there should be some normal lordosis. You have to keep your hand always there and then find out the hip which is to be tested, whether it is flexed or it is on the couch. If it is flexed, try to gently push the thigh down to the couch. Try to go for the normal, make it neutral position. If you are not able to do and if the spine is coming away from your finger, it means that is the point where the flexion deformity is there. So the angle made by the thigh and the couch is the angle of the fixed flexion deformity. So this, you have to really do it correctly. The examiner will not take it lightly if you're failing to make out a fixed flexion deformity. What are the other difficulties in doing this? If there is a fused spine. So if there is a fused spine like an ankylosing spondylitis, if there is a rounded kyphosis, then the patient will not be able to conceal his fixed flexion deformity. So the fixed flexion deformity will be obvious. So it will look, the hip will be flexed and he cannot keep the thigh on the couch. So that is when you have to find out whether there is spine is mobile or not. And when there is a fixed flexion deformity of the knee, if it is there, then you bring the patient to the end of the couch or to the side and then try to bring the thigh down towards the couch, allowing the leg to hang down. So that will take away the fixed flexion deformity of the knee and then find out whether there is any FFD of the hip. What do you do if bilateral hip disease is there and bilateral FFD is there? So you can either do the same Thomas hip knee flexion test. Both hips you can flex. One hip you try to extend. Keep your hand beneath the lumbar spine. When the spine starts again becoming lordotic, that is the angle of that hip, and then do the same thing on the other side. So that is one way. The second way will be to make the patient prone. So this is the way. So this hand should be at the lumbar spine. It should always make sure that the spine is not lordotic or it is not moving. It is only the movement which is happening at the hip, and then start extending. As you keep on extending, when the spine starts becoming again lordotic, that is the angle. So this angle is the amount of the fixed flexion deformity of that hip. So either consequently, you can do it on the other side also. So one by one you can do. So the bilateral FFT you can either do by this prone method or the supine method, flex both hips and start extending one by one. Then coming to the abduction or adduction deformity, abduction or adduction deformity. For that, you need to square the pelvis. So when you look from above, you can see that the anterior superior spine, this side is at a higher level, this is at the lower level. The limb should be along the axis of the body and parallel to the couch. So once it is done, one thing which you must always remember is that if there is an adduction, this is the affected hip. When there is an adduction deformity of the hip, there can be still further adduction which is possible. There will not be any abduction because it is already in fixed adduction deformity, but there can be further more adduction. So how do you square the pelvis? So take this limb. So the first, as you start adducting, the first movement will be the free adduction which is possible in the hip by the patient. So once, for example, if there is a 15 degree of free adduction which is possible, then for 15 degrees this limb will move. Once it has moved, exhausted the full adduction, then as you keep on adducting, it will pull down the pelvis down. So it will pull down and it comes to the same level. Once it has come to the same level, whatever angle is not the true adduction deformity, because there is also free adduction which is included in this movement. So what you have to do, bring back the limb to where the pelvis starts moving. So once the pelvis starts moving above again, so at that place you stop and then you measure. So once, for this you can keep the other limb if it is normal away and then move it. So once the pelvis starts moving above again, then that is the angle, you stop, then measure this. So this is the adduction deformity. So there is a video. So here you can see. So the anterior superior spine is at a higher level. So you connect, so this is its higher level. So start flexing, so start, sorry, adducting. As you keep adducting, this doesn't move. So once that free adduction is moved, then the pelvis moves. So now it is squared, but this angle is not the right angle because it includes the free adduction also. So you bring it back till this again starts moving up. So here it starts moving. So this is the angle of fixed adduction deformity. So that is one method. The other method of finding out what is the adduction deformity, this is Kothari's angle, measuring the Kothari's angle. So if this is elevated, draw a midline, keep both lower limbs parallel. So you draw a perpendicular to this anterior superior spine. Connect both anterior superior spine. So whatever angle here is the adduction deformity. So without even squaring the pelvis, you can measure what is the adduction deformity which is in this hip by drawing the Kothari's angle. One line draw is connecting both anterior superior spine. The other line is a perpendicular to the anterior superior spine from the mid axis of the body. So for this, the limb should be parallel and it should be along the axis. So this way you can do. Now coming to the rotation, how do you do the check the rotation? So it can be checked in three ways. One is in supine, either by a log rolling method, that is called the hip, the thigh and the leg, and you roll together. Look at the patella as the marker and the foot, and then find out how much. It is less accurate, are liable to make mistakes. Or you can flex the hip and knee to 90 degrees and then check for the rotation. The other method is by keeping the patient in prone position. That will be, I feel that it is more accurate. Here the hip will be in extension and knee can be flexed. In hip in extension and hip in flexion, you'll have to check for the rotation. And you'll have to tell the examiner separately. In hip in extension, how much is the rotation? Hip in flexion, how much is the rotation? So in a prone position, if you are doing it, make sure that the pelvis is on the couch. If you rotate it and if the pelvis gets lifted off, so if you are doing the internal rotation, if this pelvis is lifting up, then it means that the the rotation is not happening at the hip. So you have to keep your hand here, check whether the pelvis is on the couch, and then rotate. So this is, you should always remember that when it goes away, this is internal rotation, because you might make mistake because it will confuse you in prone position. So this is internal rotation, this is external rotation. In the same way, the supine position. So here also there can be a fallacy. So here if you see, the limb is a little abducted. The limb is abducted and then you check for the external rotation. So it looks almost like 70-80 degrees, but actually it is not the right way to do it. So how you must do it is, you have to keep the limb exactly perpendicular to the patient's body axis, and then you will have to rotate. So this is around 30-40 degrees of external rotation. So never allow the limb to sag on the abduction and then check for the rotation, because it might give you a wrong value of excessive external rotation. And once you have done that, hip in flexion like this and hip in extension, you'll have to tell the examiner how much is the rotation in extension and in flexion. So normally in a normal patient, in extension, the rotation may be a little less, and in flexion, the rotation may be a little more because the ligamentum digitorum is relaxed. So if it is in flexion, it becomes decreased. And if there is a significant difference, it means that there is a differential rotation. So this differential rotation indicates that the sphericity of the femoral head is lost, and the flattened femoral head, the anterolateral aspect, if it comes, engages into the acetabulum, that reduces the range of movement rotation in the hip joint. So this is a very important finding, which you'll have to say in extension as well as in flexion. So once that is done, the range of movement is over, then you'll have to come for the measurement. There are two measurements, apparent measurement and true measurement. Apparent is, as the limbs are lying parallel and don't correct any deformity, you take a fixed point from the ziphy sternum or from the umbilicus, it is better, from the ziphy sternum and to the medial malleolus and check. So what is the need for checking for the apparent measurement? What the patient is able to conceal the deformity or compensate the deformity. So this is for prescribing an orthotic. If you are prescribing an orthotic, you are going to give a sole rise, heel and sole rise. It should be for the apparent measurement and not for true measurement, because that is what he has already adapted. True measurement is after squaring the pelvis, both anterosacral spine at the same level, keep both lower limbs in identical position, and then check from anterosacral spine to the medial joint line and up to the medial malleolus. Remember that Bryant's triangle is a true measurement. So you will have to square, and then only you have to check whether it is in the supratrochanteric shortening or not. I hope that you all know that Bryant's triangle, a perpendicular from the anterosacral spine to the couch, the distance from the trochanter to that perpendicular where it cuts, that is the base of the Bryant's triangle, which indicates whether there is any supratrochanteric shortening or not. There is one simple method, we as the examiner will try to find out whether you have done this measurement correctly or not. If there is an adduction deformity, the limb will appear short. There will be an apparent shortening because the pelvis is lifted up, and the true shortening may not be the same. So the true length will be more than the apparent length. So for each 10 degree of adduction deformity, there will be 1 centimeter discrepancy. So this is how we find out. So if there is a 20 degree adduction deformity, if you say that apparent length, the true length is 2 centimeters, there is apparent shortening of 2 centimeters and true shortening, there is no shortening, then we'll always accept. But if there is a gross discrepancy, then we'd like to measure again. Otherwise, we'll not take the trouble of going and measuring again. So this formula you must know. As Dr. Naresh was telling, it is the hip joint examination is max, and if you get the max right, then your calculation and your presentation will be right. So this is what the Bryant's triangle measurement, this is the trochanter, this is the perpendicular to the couch from the anterosacral spine, another perpendicular to this line to the top of the trochanter, and this is the base of the Bryant's triangle. So the other lines, what we'll expect is the Nellaton's line, the Shoemaker's line, the Genie's test. So this Nellaton's line is very important in case of a bilateral hip. This other lines you can draw, Shoemaker's line, Genie's test, and Morris bitrochanteric test. So this is Nellaton's line. If the patient is, it is better, you check the Nellaton's line in lateral position, hip is flexed to 90 degrees from the ischial tuberosity to the anterior iliac spine. But don't say if the patient is not able to flex to 90 degrees, I did not draw the Nellaton's line, because the trochanter, whether it is in extension or in flexion, it forms a smooth arc and it should never be above the line. So if the trochanter is above the line, it means that there is some shortening. It is preferable because in flexion, you'll be able to palpate the ischial tuberosity and the rest of the bony prominence is easily. but not necessarily that always it should be in flexion. Even if it is not coming up to 90 degree flexion, it's a bilateral hip, definitely you are supposed to do the Nelaton's line. The Shoemaker's line, if this is a normal side, both if it is normal, it should intersect at the level of the umbilicus. If it is at a lower level, then it cuts on the opposite side below the umbilicus. So a line drawn from the trochanter to the anterosacral spine, if it is extended, it should go and touch the umbilicus. So here, if it is low, from the trochanter to the anterosacral spine, it goes and touches on the opposite side inferior to the umbilicus. You measure the muscle bulk, which you know, do the special tests, the vascular sign of Narada, I've already told, the telescopy to detect any unstable hip, the Trendelenburg sign. Telescopy is flex, adduct, and then push. So the one thing which is the fingers, you have to stabilize the hip, feel for the trochanter to touch the hand, and then if you pull, if it should go up and touch. So this instability is the telescopy. The Trendelenburg sign is to check the integrity of the abductor muscle. So this is the hip joint, head within the femur. This is the opposite hip. If the patient is standing on the affected side or on one leg stands, if the abductor integrity is there, then it will keep the load up or above. If the load comes down or the opposite hip sags, it means that the Trendelenburg sign is positive. So it is to test the functional integrity of the abductor muscle, abductor mechanism. The fulcrum is the hip joint. Then the lever is the head and neck of femur. And the power arm is the abductor groove. So when it will be positive? So first is make the patient stand on the normal side and then the affected side. Normally, the pelvis on the non-weight bearing side will go to a higher level. If it is positive, it means if there is an abductor apparatus integrity is lost, the pelvis on the non-weight bearing side will sag down. That is the sound side, which is the non-weight bearing side, will sag. Sound side sags. So this will help you to remember that. So you can look from the front. You can see the anterosacral spine, whether the level, this is weight bearing, the normal side. You remember that the hip should not be flexed. So hip should be in neutral position extension. Only the leg should be off the ground and see whether the anterosacral spine goes up. So it goes up. If you are looking from the back, then you have to see the gluteal fold or the posterior superior spine. Find out whether it goes up. So this is Trendelenburg's positive. Where there is a defect here, the side sags down because it is not able to pull it up. Normally, the abductor will pull the hip up and this pelvis will go up. So this is the basis of the Trendelenburg sign. If the Trendelenburg is positive, if there is a problem in fulcrum, it may be because of the dislocation of the hip joint. If there is a lever problem, it can be a fracture, neck of femur or a trochanteric fracture, non-union. If it is abductor, if there is a paralysis of the abductor in poliomyelitis or any other muscle paralyzing condition, or it's decreased effectiveness. According to, in Coxa-Vara, the examiner will commonly ask why the Trendelenburg sign is positive, which component is not right. So you'll have to say as the power arm, because the gluteus medius is right, the lever is right, fulcrum is right, but according to Frank Starling law, the power of the muscle depends upon the initial length of the muscle fiber. So from the trochanter to the ilium, the length is decreased in Coxa-Vara. So because of that, the Trendelenburg sign will be positive. The Trendelenburg sign should not be done if there is a fixed coronal plane deformity, there is a fixed adduction or abduction deformity, then that side, making the patient stand doesn't mean anything because the pelvis is already fixed in one position. It cannot show the other, the tilt. If it is an ankylosed hip and there is no movement happening, if the patient cannot weight bear on a single leg for more than 30 seconds, or if there is a gross shortening, the child is under 5 years. So these are the conditions when you should not do the Trendelenburg sign. You can just tell. So this is modified if there is a severe painful hip. Patient is not able to stand single leg for more than 30 seconds. So this is a modified Trendelenburg. So what you can do is you can hold both the, ask the patient to hold on both of your hands, the examiner hand, and ask him to stand. So the left hip is affected. When the left hip is affected, for him to balance and not to fall down, what he'll do is he'll give pressure on the right side. So here you can see the patient is trying to balance himself by pushing the examiner's on the left hand or using his right hand, he pushes. So opposite hand, he'll push down the examiner's hand. So this is a modified Trendelenburg's test. So to complete, you'll have to check for the lymph nodes, distal vessels and nerves. You have to check the sacroiliac joint. For sacroiliac joint, don't do the pump handle test or the Patrick's test or other things, because if the hip is involved doing flexing and other things, it will be painful, so it doesn't mean anything. So if you want to check for the sacroiliac joint, you'll have to direct tenderness or the posterior superiliac spine or the compression distraction test of the pelvis. So these are the two tests you have to do to check, because examiner will ask you, did you check the SA joint? How did you do it? In the presence of hip pathology, don't say that I've done the Patrick's test, the Faber's, the flexion abduction external rotation, because a painful pathology in the hip will give you a false result. Spine, you have to check the movement, the modified Schober's, the contralateral hip, ipsilateral knee, you'll have to check the abdomen. Never forget to check for the chest expansion. So you'll have to tell, as one question which was asked, whether it will anatomical and pathological diagnosis, you'll have to tell the anatomical diagnosis, which are only four. So either it can be synovitis or arthritis, it can be coxa vara, it can be unstable hip, or it is an enclosed. So these are the only four diagnoses which are possible: synovitis or arthritis, coxa vara, unstable hip and ankylosis. So I'll just briefly tell you what are the findings. In synovitis, the attitude will be a flexion and abduction external rotation. There will be apparent lengthening. Range of movement will be full, but extremes of range of movement will only be painful. So that is synovitis. Arthritis, there will be joint line tenderness. There will be flexion, adduction because of the adductor spasm. There will be fixed deformities. The range of movement will be restricted, and any available range of movement will be painful. There will be true shortening. So this is the characteristic of arthritis. In ankylosis, it can be either true, it can be a fibrous ankylosis, where there can be jog of movement, just should be a jog of movement, or you may not be able to actually demonstrate or see any movement, but any attempted movement is painful. So this is the most important finding in a fibrous ankylosis. You attempt to move, the patient will have pain. So that is an unsound ankylosis or a fibrous ankylosis. Bony ankylosis is, there is no movement which is possible. So if you attempt to move the hip, it will be painless because it is already fused. Coxa vara, the classical finding will be, there will be an adduction deformity, there will be restriction of abduction and internal rotation, there will be exaggerated adduction and external rotation, there can be a true supratrochanteric shortening, and Trendelenburg sign should be positive. In an unstable hip, there will be exaggerated range of movement, Trendelenburg's will be positive, there will be a Trendelenburg gait, and the most important is, of course, the telescopy positive. So that will tell you that it is unstable hip. So this protrusion, I want to just tell you, there will be unidirectional range of movement, the flexion extension will be possible, reasonably come full, but the adduction, abduction, rotation will be grossly restricted. So the unidirectional range of movement, if you check the Morris bitrochanteric test, that distance from the pubic symphysis to the trochanter, it will be reduced inside. And this is the time when you have to say that the perirectal examination, we don't expect to do, but you should always say that perirectal examination will be useful in this case, if you are diagnosing a protrusion stubble, which I didn't do. The common mistakes what the students will be doing are, if it is a bilateral hip, always consider that either it can be an inflammatory arthritis, a polyarthritic condition. So you'll have to check for polyarthritic condition. Don't diagnose bilateral tuberculosis or bilateral infection. The uncommon, it is possible, but uncommon things are always uncommon. So, or it can be a avascular necrosis. So for inflammatory arthritis, you'll have to check for the SA joint, which I've already told, and the chest expansion. Because if these two things, if you have not mentioned in the case sheet, then you will not be taken kindly. So please remember to do SA joint examination and chest expansion always. In fractured neck of femur, what is the cause for pain? So don't say as avascular necrosis, because the weight is not going across the femoral head and into the acetabulum. The head will be always spherical. The cartilage space will always be maintained, though it will not be viable. So the cause for pain is only the weight bearing has become, the capsule has become the weight bearing structure. So it becomes hypertrophied, thickened, and that traction on the soft tissue produces pain. And how will you manage? So all those things. So coming to the management, after you have diagnosed, you give a differential diagnosis. And when you're asked about management, you ask for investigation. As initially told, don't keep on saying negative history like that. Don't keep on saying blood TCDC, ESR, MATO, all those things. Because even in your clinical examination, the X-ray is the first thing what you can order and immediately get it. The other things will take time. So ask for the X-ray and other investigations will come, supporting investigations a little later. The management plan, always discuss with the patient before you come to the examination presentation. So don't say that I'll discuss with the patient, sir, and then I'll tell you. So what is that you want? So you have a discussion, have a clear-cut plan, and then tell. So to conclude my talk, a good brief history, a lucid presentation will take you through the examination. And clarity in presentation is very important. So keep on presenting. That will improve your presentation skill. So case sheet, you write completely because that is whatever is written, that is what is going to speak. Have the adequate differential diagnosis and appropriate investigation. Have a good management plan. So with all these things, I think that HIP is the easiest of the examination and you can get good results. So best wishes for the exam and have a brilliant career.
Thank you, Dr. Venu.